song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield, though troubles linger still. Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. I know. He's always by my side.
Color guard, attention. Color guard, forward march. Color guard, halt. Flag bearers, prepare to post the colors. Please post the colors. Audience, please rise. Join us in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Two. Flag bearers, please return to post. Color guard, about face. Color guard, forward march. Color guard, halt. Color guard, dismissed. You may be seated.
Welcome to Taylor Chapel on this bright and sunny morning. Spring is just around the corner. It's a beautiful day today. I'm so happy that all of you are with us this morning. If you are first-time visitors, we especially welcome you and invite you to get plugged into our community of faith. There are Connect cards in front of you, and I encourage you to fill one of those out and drop it in the offering plate on the way out. Lots of things going on in the life of the church this week. I encourage you to look at your bulletin. We got Valentine's Day on Tuesday with a luncheon as well as a dinner and jazz band in the evening. And Dereck's going to talk to you about lots of other exciting things happening in the, not only in the life of our church, but in the life of the Jesus movement throughout our country. I encourage you to stand now as you're able, and let's join in singing some praise songs.
Through every battle, every heartbreak, every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress. Oh, you are my portion. You are my hiding place. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. Protector, you are the one I love. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth,
the life,
the life. And it's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because they can't stay long when I'm here with you. And it's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, well, they can all come true, because they can't stay long when I believe you are the way,
the truth,
the truth. They can all come true, because they can't stay long when I believe you are the way. Ooh, yeah. anxious thought that steals my breath. It's a heavy weight upon my chest as I lie awake and wonder what the future will hold. Help me to remember that you're in control. You're my courage when I worry in the dead of night. You're my strength cause I'm not strong enough to win this fight. You're greater than the battle raging in my mind. I will trust you, Lord. I will fear no more. I will lift my eyes. I will lift my cares. Lay them in. When the wind and waves are coming, you shelter me. Even though I'm in this storm is not in me. You're my courage when I worry in the dead of night. You're my strength cause I'm not strong enough to win this fight. You've already come. No darkness can overwhelm me, cause you've already won. No power can come against me, cause you have overcome. No darkness can overwhelm me, cause you've already won. You're my courage when I worry in the dead of night. You're my strength and I'm not strong enough to win this fight.
That is correct. We fear no more. We do not fear anything that comes before us because you are our God. You are our Savior. You are the King of Kings, the Prince of Peace, the Lord of Lords. All and everything is in you. And we know that we have the courage to face whatever comes before us because we know that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither height nor depth, nor any powers, nor anything in all creation can separate us from the love of God that is in you. And we know that we are your victors. We have read the end of the book, and we know who wins. We have no fear. And we thank you and praise you for all your many blessings. In Jesus' name we pray.
You may be seated.
We won't fear the battle. We won't fear the night. We will walk the valley with you by our side. You will go before us. You will lead the way. We have found a refuge only you can save. Sing with joy now. Our God is for us.
The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Even when I stumble, even when I fall, even when I turn back, still your love is sure. You will not abandon, you will not forsake, you will cheer me onward with never-ending grace. Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Can separate us. Hell and death will not defeat us. He who gave his son to free us holds me in his love. Neither height nor depth can separate us. Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, though love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, though love is greater. Who can stand against us? God is for us.
Amen. Thank you. Good morning. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord this morning on this sunny, beautiful Sunday. I guess there's a football game sometime today. I don't much care about it. I don't mean to sound like a sad sport, but oh well, you know. But anyway, it is so good to be here on this sunny, beautiful Sunday, and I'm so glad you're here with us to celebrate our Lord Jesus and what God is doing in our lives. One thing I wanted to mention a couple things first. One, we have a Ash Wednesday service you'll see on your bulletin. This is coming up, and it's hard to believe Lent's going to be here. I mean, we just got finished with Advent, right? And here Lent's upon us. But on this Ash Wednesday, there's a couple things that I want to have you thinking about now. On Ash Wednesday, we're going to gather here, and we're going to kick Lent off. And I want you to be in prayer about this service. It's my favorite service of the year. But to be in preparation for it, what you need to be thinking about is, what is it that I want to give to God this Lent season? What thing in my life is holding me back? What thing is making me struggle? What thing is separating me from the love of God and doing what God is calling me? And we're going to give that thing up on Ash Wednesday. And then number two, I want you to think about, what is it that God is calling me to do? What is it in my life that I need to be doing that I'm not doing, that I can plug right into that space I make available by getting rid of that other thing? So if you would, please start thinking and praying about what that is that God's calling you to do. And we'll be having our Ash Wednesday service, and we'll give those things we'll give that thing up to God, and we'll offer the other thing
And please be thinking about it and invite anybody that you know to that service. We'll be having Wednesday night services all through Lent. We've got an excellent lineup of musicians and speakers. Each Wednesday will be very, very, it'll be entertaining. It will be an opportunity to learn. It'll be an opportunity to fellowship. It should be quite a season. We'll start those off with a supper each night before our actual gathering. So put those down on your schedule. And with that being said, I want to take a moment. I want to introduce Adam Dunlap. Where's Adam at? There, Adam. Come on up, Adam. Adam leads our scouting group here at Taylor Chapel, and we have one of the best scouting groups I've ever seen. A lot of the churches I've served have had scouting, but our group is large in number. They're large in spirit. They learn a lot, and Adam and Julia and others help a lot with that. So today is Boy Scout Sunday. And with that, Adam wants to say a few things. Good morning.
Morning, everyone. My name's Adam Dunlap. Some of you know me, some of you don't. My wife is Julia, and I have two sons, Caleb, who's 19, and Corbin, who's 16, both of whom who have achieved the prestigious and challenging rank of Eagle. And in addition, applause worthy. And we have some others coming up, too, that should be earning their scout rank or their Eagle rank here very shortly. In addition to teaching Bible classes here, I've also been heavily involved in scouting for about 13 years. I am currently scoutmaster for Troop 34B, committee member for Troop 34G, which is the girl troop, a unit commissioner for Troop 460, PAC, and PAC 3460, and I have a new role in the Cub Scout PAC, which is PAC committee chairman. I would like to first of all recognize all those who are serving or have served in the past, young people in our community through Boy Scouts of America organization, and those who have participated in the program as a youth. So would those who either are or were involved in scouting anyway, please stand. Let's give them a round of applause. To give you a little update on the units here at Taylor Chapel, and all of our units are owned by the church, so the church has a vested interest in these programs. It is a ministry of this church. The boy troop has about 15 scouts, and the girl troop has four right now, a very strong four. About four of the scouts in both of those units are just about to earn their Eagle. They're very close to starting their Eagle projects and getting that finished, which is really exciting. We haven't had, other than my own two sons, we haven't had, and one other, this is going to be our largest influx of Eagle scouts in a long time, so really excited about that. Both units logged almost 300 hours of service time in this last year, mostly in service that, absolutely. And most of them have been in service to the church. Of course, the church helps us out by giving us a space, so it's a wonderful partnership. The PAC was shut down, actually, at the first this year, simply because I couldn't do it all anymore. However, amazing thing happened at that time. Almost every single parent in that unit stepped up to take the reins to make it happen. And you can't imagine how happy this makes me that they thought that this program was too important to die. And I'm just very excited about that. We have a new Cub Master, and I've taken on the role of committee chair in order to help train that position. And he has tons of people underneath him now to help support him. So that's the way scouting is supposed to work, and we're very excited about that. So the future for the PAC is very bright as well. So why are we here today? Why is this goofy guy up here in this weird-looking tan shirt up here talking to you? Well, today is Scout Sunday. The Boy Scouts of America designates the Sunday that falls before February 8th, which is the anniversary of Scouts, as Scout Sunday, which is the primary date to recognize the contributions of young people and adults to scouting. An organization such as ours can choose another date, which we choose always the second Sunday of February. The big question, why scouting at Taylor Chapel? Well, first of all, a scout is reverent, and reverent is the final point of the scout law. It's not at the end because it's the least important. It's at the end for the form of emphasis. In our units, we take this last point of the scout law very seriously. Sir Robert Baden Powell, the original founder of Boy Scouts, stated, "There is no religious side to the scouting movement. The whole of it is based on religion, that is, on becoming aware of God and His service." And that is from the Headquarters Gazette, November of 1920, over 100 years ago. And I could literally talk about religion and scouting all day, but to keep it short, it simply comes down to one word, and that word is love. The scouting units are primarily designed to show love to the community by equipping young people for service to God, to country, and their neighbors. We teach them skills such as first aid, emergency prep, amongst many other things, to serve others. That's how we show love to others. In short, we teach them the verb of love. Love is a verb. Love's not that gushy feeling you feel in your stomach. Love is an action word, and we take that seriously. Conversely, we are teaching them to give through selfless service, and they are also learning to receive love from the church in forms of support, mentoring, encouragement, and most of all, the dissemination of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the very source of love. That is why we are really here today, to show our appreciation for Taylor Chapel and all that you have done for us, but also to give you the opportunity to minister to us the gospel in your words and your actions. Thank you.
Thank you, Adam. At this time, would the kids come on up? Come on up, kids. Is this on, guys? Is this on? Hey, everybody. So glad you're here. I'm going to have to ask somebody to leave. Miss Angela? I'm sorry, but I'm going to have to ask you to leave. No, you can't go home. You just have to leave the room. Okay. Bye, Miss Angela. Shh. Is she gone?
Not yet.
Oh, is she still stinking around? Yeah. Boy, she's hard to get rid of sometimes, didn't she? Come on up here, Gracie. I think she's about out of here. You know, this week's a big deal to Pastor Dereck. I've got big problems, okay? Tuesday's Valentine's Day. You know, that's that mushy love day. Yeah, and then Wednesday's Miss Angela's birthday. And then Thursday's my anniversary. So, I'm in a heap of trouble, okay? And I'm going to need you guys to help me, all right? So, let me show you something here. The reason I had to get rid of Miss Angela is because I wanted you guys to help me. Charlie, could you make a little space for me here, hon? Yeah. Oh, did I hit your hand? Sorry there, buddy. Hey, Charlie, you can sit right down here. Scoot over just a little bit, Mr. Jackson. Oh, you can't? You're stuck there, too. Sit down, Miss Charlie. Okay, let me show you what I got, Miss Angela, so far, okay? I went all the way over to Meijer, rushed in there, and look, and I'm just showing you guys what I got. First, I got her this cute little teddy bear. You think she's going to like that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so, too. It's kind of fuzzy, and it's got a little belly like Pastor Dereck. I think she's going to think about me when she sees that. And also, guess what I got her? I got her these really expensive chocolates from Meijer. They're,
I got those.
Did you get those, too? You got them at the Dollar Tree?
Yes.
Well, I should have went to the Dollar Tree.
Yeah.
You did? Okay. But, you know, I got these because because Miss Angela's sweet like candy, you know, and I'm going to tell her that, you know, she's sweet like candy. I got her that. And then Pastor Dereck got this. See this? This is a beautiful card. They saw Pastor Dereck come, and I paid $6.99 for this nonsense. But if I'd have known that before I got to the cash register, they wouldn't have got me for that one. But, I was reading it, and it says stuff like, it says, I know we say I love you all the time, but sometimes I get a little lost in the shuffle of everyday life. So on Valentine's Day, I want to say I love you. Isn't that romantic? You think she's going to like that? I think she'll like it. But, you know, I was thinking that I think the best gifts are things that people do themselves that come from the heart. So I was hoping that you guys could help me this morning. I want to write a love letter. And I'm not very good with love letters.
I.
You're not either? Okay. Well, we might be in trouble. But anyway, oh, sorry. I've got my pad and my paper right here, and I'm going to need some help, okay? No, that's not going to help at all. Okay, now, how should I start my love letter? Anybody got any ideas? Yeah, you do? What?
I do.
Here, please stop that, okay? What's your idea? She has nothing. This isn't working. What do you say, Jackson?
Miss Angela?
Yeah, dear Miss Angela. That's a good way to start, isn't it? That's good. Here, please don't do that, okay? Dear Miss Angela. Okay, what can I say after that? Anybody got any ideas? Yes. What do you think? Here, you're going to have to stop that, son, okay? You need to quit that. What should I say after dear Miss Angela? You make life worth it. Oh, that's good stuff. You make life worth it. Oh my goodness, that's gold. That is gold. You got what do you have, honey? What do you think?
Person.
You're a good person. That's a good one. I like that. Charlie, can you think of anything? No? Anybody else? Zoe, can you think of anything? What else could I say to Miss Angel?
You're as strong as a diamond.
You're as what?
Strong as a diamond.
You're strong as a diamond. Oh, my goodness. Oh, I can't wait. She's going to love this. Zoe, you might get me through this season. You're as strong as a diamond. That's good. Oh, that's a good one. Okay, I got to finish up this letter. How can I finish it? You got any idea?
Make an idea. You are prettier.
Oh, you are prettier. She'd like to think that too. I'm gonna write that down. What else?
You're tough as the ground.
You're as tough as the ground. That is the way I'm gonna finish it. You are prettier, and you are tough as the ground. Love, Pastor Dereck. Why, you guys? Let's hear it for the kids. I think they really bailed me out this time. Woo! I just might get through this week. You know, I was thinking that, you know, that God wrote us a love letter. Did you know that? Yes, I was thinking about it this week, that in the Bible, there's all kinds of places where God tells us how much he loves us and how much he cares. One of the places is in John 3:16, where it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave us his only son, that we should not perish but have life." So God loves us so much that he gave us Jesus so that we could live. And today we're looking at Romans, and if this doesn't sound like Valentine's Day poetry, I don't know what does. Listen to this. "For I am convinced neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present or the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate you, Miss Angela, from me, Pastor Dereck." Doesn't that sound like a love letter?
Yes.
Yes. You know, God loves us, and he tells us all the time in his book, the Bible, and we should always look at it. Now, one of the things I want to tell you right before we go is that this coming Tuesday, I want each one of you to be sure to tell people that you love them.
You need to let your grandparents, your parents, your teachers, your friends, your aunts and uncles, all those people that are so good to you, you don't have to buy them fancy gifts like Pastor Dereck did with that teddy bear. It was cute. Thanks, Jackson. But, you know, you can always just tell them you love them. Or you could even have an adult help you write a letter or write it yourself. Be sure to tell people that you love them. It's important to them, okay? Let's remember that at Valentine's Day. Let's pray. Dear God, I thank you for these kids. And Lord, I just pray that they will learn to love and that they will accept the love that you offer them. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Let's hear it for our kids. You all can go with Miss Ashley, okay? Oh, she thinks I should put XOXO at the end. Look at that cute little teddy bear. Woo! You know, this week, where'd my microphone go? It's there somewhere. There it is. This week was kind of a struggle. I've had illness for the last couple weeks. I've been tired and kind of sick. Well, I tell you, this old world, you just got to turn the news off sometimes. I mean, you just have to. We're in a mess. We're in an absolute mess. I just the Game Show Network, you ever watch that? It's a lot easier to watch that than the news. And sometimes I just have to go there, you know. But one thing happened this week that I don't know how many of you are aware of, but I wanted to make you aware of it this morning because it's something that we as Christians talk about. Some of us have experienced it. It's maybe an old-fashioned kind of word that's gone by the wayside. There's this word called revival. You heard it? The word revival. And one of the things about revival is that in order to be revived, you had to have been alive. Right? And revival, it can mean a lot of things. It can mean a person first coming to Christ, and that's part of revival. But it's also for us who have known Christ for years. And when we rededicate ourselves, or something, a movement of the Holy Spirit, where we're filled with a spirit that guides and directs us and leads us in directions that we sometimes don't understand. You're going to see up here, this is Asbury College, or University, in Wilmore, Kentucky. And Aaron, our buddy Aaron, actually goes there. Aaron Lewis, Gordy, you guys, Nancy back there, would you stand up? Just Gordy and Nancy, their son Aaron goes there, and I've visited there before, and on Wednesday they had chapel, just like any other Wednesday. They always have chapel on Wednesdays, and that picture was taken last night. Chapel's still not over. There is a revival going on. I talked with two different people who were there in person. Pastor Evan Goose down in Upland, Indiana. I talked with him. He had a post on Facebook, and the crowd is getting bigger. There is a revival there. And when he talked about what was going on and what it was like, he said it was like a feeling of serenity, a feeling of peace, an unexplained kind of peace that he felt when he walked into the chapel there on their campus. Now, Asbury has a seminary, but this revival started in the university. It didn't start in the seminary. And it started with a group of young people having their regular Wednesday service, and a movement of the Holy Spirit took place. And these people just started to praise and sing. They had no desire to leave. I read one person post that he was late because he had so many things going on with his classes and that he had studies. And that he went in for 1 hour. And he said he left after an hour. He said he had the feeling that he'd been there all day. And that it was a feeling like time stood still. And when I saw this, I thought, oh, I would love to be there. Wouldn't you love to be in that room and feel that presence and be a part of that movement, that thing that's going on there? And we pray for that, don't we? But you know what? We don't have to go there. That same Spirit is in this room today. That same Spirit dwells inside of those who know Christ. Those in this room who know Christ have that same Spirit. And today, you don't have to go to Wilmore, Kentucky to feel the presence of the Holy Spirit. You don't have to go to Wilmore, Kentucky to have revival. As we come into Lent, let us all pray for revival here at Taylor Chapel, that we could be the salt and light. You know, this old world has a way of kicking us around. It has a way of hurting us, making us feel less. But God didn't give us that kind of spirit. He didn't give us that kind of spirit. And that's what we're going to talk about today. We've been in the book of Romans chapter 8 now since the beginning of the year, and I have to tell you, I am so glad that the Spirit led me to start our year in Romans 8. I'm going to miss having it all week with me as the weeks go on and we go into other things. It has been just a blessing to me. And today, we're going to look at the very end of pretty much a series of things that Paul says. And this book is broken into the first 8 chapters. It's all kind of related to it. And what we're going to read today is the end of that particular message that Paul has for us. And it is some of the most inspiring, uplifting, positive scripture that there is in all of the Bible. It's gold. It is absolute gold. And it's written in such a way where it's Paul asks these rhetorical questions. You know what a rhetorical question is. You know, it's a statement with a question mark on the end of it that starts with who or why or what, you know. We use them all the time. I use them. You know, it's like when you post something on a social media site and you put an exclamation mark and a question mark with an exclamation mark. You know, sometimes I get clever and I'll do question mark, exclamation, question mark. Sometimes I do it the other way. You know, just depending on what I'm wanting to say. But these are rhetorical questions, and Paul answers his own questions here. Because what they are is they're promises, they're statements that should inspire all people who know Christ. And it should inspire people who don't know Christ to get to know Christ. Because these are promises, and as we've been talking, God keeps his promises. He keeps his promises. So these are solid. Paul starts out by saying this, and let's follow along with me. Read this to yourself as I read, because this is so powerful. Hear what Paul says. He says, what then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charges against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble, hardship, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let's applaud the words of the pastor. Do you believe this morning? Is this how you live your life? with no fear, no intimidation, no condemnation? Do people see a person who is more than a conqueror when they see you or hear your words or look at your life? Paul's telling us there is no intimidation. If God is for us, who can be against us? There is no limitation. He has freely and fully given us all things in Christ Jesus. There is no accusation. Who shall lay anything on God's elect? How dare you? No, Christ died, he rose again, and he intercedes for us. There is no condemnation because we are more than conquerors. For the believer, there is no separation. For who will separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus? Friends, God is not only our Father, but he's our friend. Someone who won't abandon you. It's not like earthly relationships where you might get left or cheated on or pushed aside. That isn't how it works with God. His promise is gold. He will be there. He says he'll be there. He will be there. He'll be there with you when you mourn, when you cry, when you rejoice, when you dance, when you celebrate, and any occasion in between. If you belong to him, you belong to him. And he'll never let you go. I want you to say it with me this morning. I want you to say, we are more than conquerors. Let's say it together, will you? So you can feel it. Let's say it together. We are more than conquerors. Does that feel good? You've got to believe it. This week when I was reading these words, and I get up through the week and I always read the scripture in the morning to myself, and I kind of plan it there in the front part of my brain, so throughout the day I might hear things that remind me or think of things that was in the scripture. And long about Tuesday or Wednesday, I can't remember which, I was reading this scripture, and I was reading this part that we are more than conquerors. And it reminded me of a time I had way back in 1982 when I attended a concert at Market Square Arena. I saw the sold-out show of Queen, the British band Queen. And I wasn't a huge Queen fan, but I was just overtaken about the excitement that the crowd had when they came out for their encore. They have an encore, and they had this song that's We Will Rock You. And you'll probably hear it today during the Super Bowl. You hear it a lot at, you know, sporting events. It's a rock anthem. It's one of those things that get people riled up. But the big part of the show for me was right after they do that song, they went in to a song that many will say is the greatest rock ballad, anthem ballad of all times. And it's a song that says, "We are the champions, my friends." You know that song, don't you? "We are the champions, my friend." And when they came out and sang that song, everybody, they lit their Bic lighters and they did this in Market Square Arena, and everybody was on their feet and everybody was singing. At times Freddie Mercury, the lead singer, would even stop singing so you could hear the whole crowd. And I was right in the middle of it, man. You heard how I sang it. You know, I was right in the middle of it. And it was such a moving moment. And you know, some interesting things about this power ballad, and that's what this is called, a power ballad. It never hit number one on the charts. You know, it's hard to believe, but there was actually a survey done by scientific research. Government probably paid for this scientific research. But the researchers dubbed it as the catchiest song in the history of pop music. And I don't know about that, but it is one of those songs that once it gets in your head, you know, it's just kind of hard to get rid of. And you know, why is it like that? Well, you know, it has a unique combination of jazzy chords in it. and it has some really great harmonies. And, you know, perhaps it's even the high C falsetto belted out by lead singer Freddie Mercury. I don't know. But any way you look at it, it embodies the quintessential power ballad that was so popular, especially in the 80s in the music. And nearly three decades after the original recording, this song was voted the world's favorite song in a worldwide music poll. You know, if I wouldn't have read that on the internet, I wouldn't have believed it. That's what it said. But, you know, whether it is or not, you all know it. I'd say everybody in here has heard that song. They're probably familiar with it. But what is it that really made it good? Why is it that everybody stood up and sang? Why is it that people remember this song? It's the lyrics. It's the lyrics, because the lyrics are affirming. They give a justifying connotation to the song. There's a justification. And it's also kind of dismissive against those who are against the group or not part of the group. You know, because no time for losers. Yeah? But most of all, it's because it's triumphant. Right? It feels victorious. You know, in a moment when you might not be feeling like it, everybody, you're standing there with 80,000 people singing, we are the champions. We are the champions. But is that true? I think back to then, and I was anything but a champion when I was in that stadium singing that song that day. And as I looked around, I didn't see a lot of champions around me. But here we are today, and we have Romans 8. And for every Christian, it is undoubtedly the greatest power ballad of all time. It smokes that Queen song, because it's true. And if you're in Christ, and you know Christ, then we are more than conquerors. We're super conquerors. Verse 31 says, "What then shall we say in response to these things?" That's how Paul starts this piece of scripture. And when he's referring to these things, what's he talking about? Yeah. Well, this part, as I told you earlier, it's a conclusion that started in the conversation from chapter 1 all the way through chapter 8. And Paul's teaching through these chapters. He talks about the sinful nature of man. He talks about the salvation of God. He talks about hope that we find in Christ for all Christians. And in the context of Romans chapter 8, when he says, "What shall we say to these things?" He's saying these things include a promise in verse 1 that there is no condemnation. There's no condemnation if you're in Christ. In verses 4 through 27, he talks about the provisions of the Holy Spirit and how this advocate spirit even instructs us how to pray when we don't know what to pray for, and leads us in ways that we don't know what to be doing. In verses 28 and 30 that we looked at last week, it talks about the sovereignty of God in salvation and how he takes all those things in our lives, the things that we might have been involved in before we knew Christ, and he takes those things and he makes them into the good. Well, how can you make all those things into good? Did you learn from them? Are you helping and instructing other people? I want to show you this hole so that you don't step in it. I'm gonna point it out to you before you fall in it. This passage of Scripture, it contains some of the most powerful promises and assurances in all the Bible. And we have the powerful promise of God regarding our security, our certainty, our justification, our sonship in Christ Jesus, and that we are forever His unconditionally as long as we are in Christ. And at the end, Paul tells us that we live with an unstoppable and undeniable conviction that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. But I personally believe that when Paul says, what shall we say about these things? I think that Paul is primarily pointing to verses 28 and 30, talking about the sovereignty of God in our salvation. You can tie the last week's verses together with what he's saying here. For we know that all things are working together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. We can connect those to the words that Paul says in verse 38, where he says, I am convinced, I'm sure, that he has us, and that we belong to him. Friends, this chapter is undeniably a confession that we live in victory and that we are more than conquerors. Friends, we are the champions. We are the champions. Then what shall we say in response to these things? This is one of the most powerful statements to me in a struggling time that I'm in right now. When people question your motives, they question your life, they question the words you say, they question your beliefs, they question everything about you. And what does Paul say? What shall we say about these things? He says, if God is for us, who can be against us? If God is for us, who can be against us? Say it with me. If God is for us, who can be against us? Who can be against us? You know, if God is for me, then it doesn't matter what my boss thinks. It doesn't matter what my neighbor says. It doesn't matter what the haters think. It doesn't matter what the atheist believes. It doesn't matter what they think about what I think, what I believe, what I know to be true. Isn't it good to know that in a cancel culture, that no one can cancel you, at least what God has done and is doing in your life because of Jesus Christ? Does that bring you hope? We are held in his hand, in his powerful grip. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 5 says, we are kept by the power of God. He keeps us. In John chapter 10, he says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. If God holds you in his hand, who's going to snatch you away? What then shall we say about these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? It's an overwhelming affirmation to all of us who cling to the promises. And if you stop and contemplate it and think on it, it can do nothing but give you victory and give you a spirit of victory and conquering. What's it look like? I saw this movie years ago. I think it was called The Bear. It was a really neat little movie. It was kind of unusual, and it showed the life of a bear and the cub. And there was one scene in the movie that I just really remember, and it reminds me of the scripture. In the movie, there was this little bear cub, and he's separated from his mom, and he's just kind of out wandering around. And as he's wandering around, just doo-doo-doo, like that little bear down there. He's wandering around, being cute. This mountain lion, fierce mountain lion, comes out, and it's terrifying. And he snarls and shows his fangs and shows his claws. And the little bear just stops in its tracks. And the mountain lion is just almost toying with the little cub, about to devour him. And you know something ugly is about to happen. I just kept thinking, run, little bear, run, little bear. And the little bear doesn't run. He just kind of stunned there. And all of a sudden, just as you know the lion's about to chew him up, that cute little bear, he jumps up on his little hind legs And he does his best to make this little growl, you know, and he's showing his nails. And as soon as he does it, the mountain lion freaks out and just turns and runs. And the little bear's just like, and the screen pans back, and then you can see right behind the bear's mama bear. And you know, that's how it is for us. You know, we're like lambs to the slaughter sometimes. You know, don't you feel it sometimes? Oh, I just can't get ahead. Oh, I just can't get past it. I just saw this and that. Just know, we got a big old God. We got a big old God standing behind us. And we have a promise that if we're in His Son Jesus, we're more than conquerors. We're that little bear and the big bear together. If God is for us, who can be against us? How do we know this? Paul explains how we can know it. How can we know? How do we know that God's so for us? You know, what has He done to show us that? Well, Paul tells us he loved us so much that He didn't even spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all. Now, if He did this, how will He not also, along with that, graciously give you all things? If God did that for you, you mean He's not going to take care of the other stuff? He's not going to do the other things for Him? You know? For those who are in Christ Jesus. That's the thing that you have to have in order. It's the ticket you have to have. You know, in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus tells us, but seek first the kingdom and His righteousness, and all things will be given to you as well. And it's not like, this is the preliminary thing that you have to know. You first have to be in Christ Jesus for this, or we're talking about something that's irrelevant to you. That's the standard. You know, I was thinking about this, and how could I describe this? And I was thinking about how if you go to a cafeteria, they don't have many of those, but when I was growing up, they used to have cafeteria. Jean's Cafeteria was a big place in my hometown. And I loved the cafeteria because you could walk down the aisle and you could have a little this, a little that, a little this, and, you know, you could pick whatever you wanted out, and you paid for it and eat it, you know. And, you know, as a kid, I'd have French fries and tater tots and mac and cheese and cake and pudding, and, you know, I'd pile the stuff on, and I could just go through and pick out anything I wanted, you know, and my dad would have to pay for it. A lot of times he'd make me put stuff back, but you had to pay for each item. And that's not how this works. This works more like a restaurant where you sit down and you choose an entree or a main dish, or a meat, you know. When you look at the menu at the restaurant, what are you ordering? Well, you can order chicken or fish or pork chops or ribeye steak. And if you buy the meat, the entree, then what do you get? You know, if you buy the meat, you also get your choice of potato, rice, vegetables. You can have cornbread or a muffin or a yeast roll, soup or salad. You know, it comes with the entree. But if you don't buy the entree, you don't get the other things. You know, and when you pay for the meat, the rest of the stuff comes with it, doesn't it? And that's the way it is with God's blessing. The main dish, the entree, is justification by faith through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And once you take that on, the other stuff comes along with it. But if you don't take the entree, you don't get the other stuff. God supplies every other need, all things, and He does it freely. But you don't get the extras if you don't order the meat. We We cannot expect God to bless and provide for our needs unless we receive the gift of salvation. You know, there's a lot of people that they like their faith or their religion cafeteria style. You know, they want to go down through and pick this and pick that and do this, but they don't want to pay for the meat. They don't want what's important. They'd just like to pass it up. It can be done that way. God will not allow it. We must first seek God's kingdom and His righteousness in Christ, and then all these will be added. Verse 33, who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? This is another rhetorical question. It's very similar to the one, if God is for us, who can be against us? You know, if God is for us, who can be against us? You know, who will bring charge against those whom God has chosen? Well, Paul gives us the answer. You know, because it's not really a question. You know, it's God who justifies. It's not them. It's not him. It's not her. It's God. Who's the one who condemns? No one. God's the only one that can do that. And there is no condemnation when you belong to Christ. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword or illness or financial difficulties or losing your job or the loss of a spouse or a wayward child or just being grumpy? Will any of that separate us? No. No. If we belong to Him, it will not separate us. Nothing can separate us. In all these things, in all these situations, in all these places that you can land in your life, if you're in Him, you can be more than a conqueror. Paul ends it this way. He says, for I am convinced. He says, I'm sure, I'm positive, it is a fact. That neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, neither present or future or any powers, neither height nor depth or anything else in all creation, nothing, absolutely nothing, there is nothing that will separate us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ, and you can take it to the bank. That's what he's saying. And then Paul just drops the mic. You know? Is this powerful to you this morning? Is this how you feel in your life this morning? Do you feel like a conqueror or somebody's just getting by? Do you feel like somebody's living an abundant life? Do you feel like somebody knows how it ends? We've already won. We've read the end of the book. We know how it ends. We know. We win. And as long as we stay in Christ, all these things will be added to it. And we can be conquerors, more than conquerors, super conquerors, super duper conquerors. Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 39. I'll quickly kind of go through these. These are the conclusions that I come from, that I came to from this. The sovereignty of God is the basis for our security. God is the basis for our security. We don't have confidence in ourselves. It's not like the We Are the Champions song where we do it. No, we are conquerors through Christ. Our security and confidence in God is the basis for our service. We don't do things for other people. We don't volunteer and do things because we want to better ourselves or look better in the eyes of God. We don't earn it. The confidence that we have in these promises should be the basis for us going and doing those things and sharing with more people these promises. Our security is never an excuse for sloppiness. Meaning, this security shouldn't be a false security. It should not be cheap grace. Meaning, I can act any way I want, and big old God is going to still come behind me like Mama Bear and protect me. We have to stay in Him. We can't get sloppy with our actions and our ways. We need to stay diligent and obedient. And number four, the scripture never raises any doubt that God will finish what He started. You ever question, the question, will God finish what He started? Will the saints endure to the end? Will we be able to endure to the end? That shouldn't be the question. The question should be, are you sure that you're in Christ? That should be the question. All of us have to ask that. If you want these promises, if you want to be more than a conqueror, you need to be sure that you're in Christ, not if God will keep His end of the deal. Number five, the basis of our salvation and our security is found in the work of Christ on the cross of Calvary. Did you notice that every fear, every dread in the text that Paul gives us is the result of sin? Every dread, every problem is the result of sin. And did you notice that every cure goes right back to the cross of Calvary? Funny how that works. And finally, the security of the believer requires a response. We have to respond. It's there, but you have to respond to it. Paul's conclusion reminds us that a revelation requires a response. The security of the believer in the sovereign love of God should produce humility, gratitude, dependence, confidence, and praise. And praise. God doesn't need our praise. We need to praise Him. Let us ponder these closing words of Romans 8, especially in contrast to the closing words of Romans 7, where Paul says, I do what I don't want to do, and I don't do what I want to do. I mess up all the time. I don't want to do it, but I do it. What a wretched man am I. Who can save me from myself? Say it with me one more time, okay? If God is for us, who can be against us? Take that with you today. And when you're struggling, something's not going well this week, when somebody's on your back, somebody's giving you a rough time, when you're hurting and you're struggling, just know something else that Paul tells us, that these present things are not worth comparing to the future glory that awaits all of us, all those who know Christ. If you know Him, cling to that. If you don't know Him, get to know Him. Please bow with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank You for this beautiful chapter in Your book of Romans, chapter 8. Lord, I thank You for the wisdom. I thank You for the way that Paul just pictures the gospel, understands it, and explains it in such a way. Father, I pray for all those here today. I pray that revival will happen here at our church. And Father, we invite Your Spirit here to dwell. Lord, help us to be the ones that catalyst this revival on this side of Fort Wayne. Lord, we thank You for these promises that Paul tells us about. And Lord, more than any, I thank You that because of what You have done for me, that I can boldly claim that I am more than a conqueror. And I pray all this in the name of Your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Be ready to come back up and send us forth when we're done with this song, all right? All right. This should be our song, okay? This should be the church's song, Our God by Chris Tomlin. I encourage you to stand and sing with me, all right? Sing with us.
No one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Into the dark you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome.
God is for us, who can be against us? Leave this place knowing, because of the work of Jesus Christ, we are more than conquerors. go out into the world and share it with others. Amen.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of